Hachette Audio presents If You Find This, written by Matthew Baker, read by Bryan Kennedy and Robert Petkoff.
Robert Rowe, I'll plant you here. Also, the one who went unnamed. Peter was alone on the lagoon. The rock was very small now. Soon it would be submerged. Peter was not quite like other boys, but he was afraid at last. A tremor ran through him, like a shudder passing over the sea. But on the sea, one shudder follows another till there are hundreds of them, and Peter felt just the one. Next moment, he was standing erect on the rock again, with that smile on his face and a drum beating within him. It was saying, "To die will be an awfully big adventure." James Matthew Barry, Peter Pan. Chapter 1. If You Find This. If I die, or get kidnapped by the Isaacs, someone needs to know the truth about what happened to my grandfather, about where my grandfather is. That's why I'm writing all of this down. I'm going to keep these notes under the clothes in my dresser. So if I'm dead, if you're reading this, that must mean you were cleaning the dresser out to throw my clothes away. Which means you found the hatchet, too. I didn't steal it. Zeke stole it. To break through the cellar door. And you found the earring. So I did steal that. But I was only keeping it to remember what the homeschooler said to Jordan. I'm going to write down exactly how everything happened. I'm not going to lie to make myself seem braver or smarter than I actually was, because I wasn't brave. I wasn't smart. I was afraid. And even if I got all A's and had square roots memorized, like the square root of 537,289, there were problems I couldn't solve alone. If I'm dead, I'm sorry. I had to risk everything. We were trying to find the heirlooms. That's what this is about. Buried heirlooms. A map made of letters and numbers. A revolver. A clock. A hammer. A box. This is about my grandfather, my father, my brother. This is about trying to save someone you love. This is what I'm saying. I need you to understand how everything happened. I need you to understand that none of it was my fault. When you're 11, you don't always get to choose between good and bad. Sometimes you have to choose between bad and bad. Sometimes you have to choose between worse and worst. Chapter 2. In the Years of Trees. My brother is a tree. He wasn't always a tree. When I was 7, my mom was pregnant, and my brother was inside her. I had been asking for a brother for years and years and years, and now I was finally going to have one. But the night before my 8th birthday, my brother came out too soon. He was half grown, unfinished. There was nothing the doctors could do. He was already dead. We hadn't even named him yet. I should have known my brother would be born too soon, because a brother being born is a big event. The doctors had predicted my brother wouldn't be born until months after my 8th birthday, but that never could have happened. Big events only happen on years that you're a prime. A prime is a number that's divisible only by 1 and itself. The primes I've been are 2, 3, 5, 7, and 11. When I was 2, our dog got hit by a truck. When I was 3, our kitchen caught on fire. When I was 5, I broke my leg. I skipped a grade, and our dog got pregnant. And we had to give away the puppies. When I was 7, my mom got pregnant, and my brother was born and died. When I turned 11, my dad got fired from the factory where he built cars and moved to the Upper Peninsula to work at my uncle's repair shop and was never home, and we had to give away our dog because we couldn't afford to feed her. Nothing like that happens years that I'm not a prime. That year that my brother died, I was 7, and my mom was 41, and my dad was 43. All of us were primes. My brother never had a chance. After my brother died, my parents said we would plant a tree so we would remember him always, and they drove away, like they had before, to the hospital when everything had gone wrong, and drove back again with a tree roped to the car, a pine, a sapling, just barely younger than me in the years of trees. After we had buried my brother in the dirt at the edge of our backyard, beyond the swing set he could not climb on and the sandbox he could not play in, we sat on the deck drinking lemonade. I was so happy to have a brother again. My parents never talked about him after that, but I understood that he wasn't dead anymore. That instead, he had become this other thing. During the years that followed, a dog snapped at me in the woods, and I got a white scar on my hand, and my dad tripped into me in the garage, and I got a white scar on my knee, and birds pecked at my brother with their beaks and scarred my brother's branches, and my dad bumped into my brother with a wheelbarrow and scarred my brother's trunk. And my brother kept my knife in the crook of his branches, and my sock sometimes hanging from his twigs, and my shoes at his roots. And I kept his pine cones on my windowsill, and fistfuls of his needles on my dresser, and his sap in a jar in my room, in the house where he could not go. And in this way, we grew together. I told him everything. Chapter 3. The Prisoner Lives. Everything started when I got home from school and my mom shouted, "Nicholas, come into the kitchen. There's something you need to know." Actually, everything started when the Isaacs found me at school and said,
"Meet us tonight, the graveyard at sunset, and don't even think about not coming."
Or actually, everything started with locker partners. Seventh grade means riding a different bus, means having a new building, means sharing lockers with locker partners. Everyone else in my grade was 13 or 12, but because I skipped kindergarten, I was still only 11. Seventh graders are in their own building across from the high school. Everyone had to choose a locker partner. No one wanted Zeke Song, so we were assigned to each other because no one wanted me either. Zeke is a thief. He steals high tops from the locker room, backpacks from the choir room, and instruments from the band room. Then he sells everything for money. He keeps the money in a gold backpack on the floor of our locker. It's not because he's a thief that everyone avoids him. Everyone avoids him because he draws mermaids on his arms in silver marker and because sometimes he barks at teachers like he's a dog. Actually, he probably still would have friends, even with the mermaid drawings and the dog barking, except for that once in fifth grade, he kissed little Isaac on the lips. That's why everyone avoids him. You can't cross little Isaac like that and still have any friends. I never saw Zeke at our locker normally. During school, he was always sneaking around, stealing. So a few days ago, I was unlocking our locker to get my sack lunch. My parents couldn't afford to buy me cafeteria lunch anymore, when I decided to unzip the gold backpack.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.